there may be other ways that we can serve our communities and serve people who are struggling. There may be ways. And so our prayer is, God, show us a way, and make us available. We want to say, here, Lord, here am I. Make me available. So let's sing this unto the Lord. And believe God is going to use us, this church, as a means to reach out. Unto us, we pray for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit, dear Lord, on us individually, on top of this hill, Lord, this body of believers, whether in person or remote. Touch us right now, dear Lord. Glory to your holy name. Hallelujah. And we do not want to forget those on our prayer list and those who are still sending their requests in, Lord. We remember them and pray that you'll touch them as well, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And just one other note, just a reminder that yes, before the end of the service, if you'd like to text Angela prayer request, feel free to do so. We'll mention those at the end of the service. And a brief testimony as well, if you like. And for those who are watching, I know for some it might be helpful. I'm not sure how to control it. We're still working out the details. But if you want to, in addition to muting the mic, just mute the video. That will enlarge the screen here, and you'll be able to see more clearly. If there's anything that goes wrong during the service, for those on the call, just text Angela, and we'll try to fix it. Things are going better. And hopefully soon, maybe next week, we'll be able to live stream. That'll be more of a one-way communication. But during our prayer times, having Skype is very beneficial because we can all join in together. And it was good this morning before service start to greet our members remotely. A cry at midnight. Admittedly, I'm looking to Scripture, not to predict what's going to happen, but to try to catch a glimpse into what God is trying to accomplish during this pandemic. We know that nothing catches him by surprise, and I believe that God is using this to accomplish his will. And his will is different at different levels. On a personal level, he's drawing his people, us, closer to him. On a national level, I believe he's molding the thinking of our leaders. He's correcting them, channeling them in his direction. And he's also accomplishing different things in different countries. He's letting it be known that there are certain principles that he has established and that they cannot be violated without suffering consequences. Proverbs 14:34 says, "Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people," or "sin is a disgrace to any people." And so as we go through this chapter 12 of Exodus and more chapters in Exodus, we see in that book the plot to abolish years of racial harmony between Jews and Egyptians and force them into slavery was a disgrace to the nation, whose leaders would not be allowed to stand. We'll start off first back in Exodus chapter 1, just to lay the groundwork. Exodus chapter 1, 10 and 11. "We've got to do something," Pharaoh is saying, because of the prosperity and the multitude of the Jews in the land. "We've got to do something," the Message translation. "Let's devise a plan to contain them, lest if there's a war, they should join our enemies or just walk off and leave us." So they organized them into work gangs and put them to hard labor under gang foremen. They built the storage cities of Pithom and Ramses for Pharaoh. So this is how it started. A different dynasty came into power with a different agenda, causing disruption and a different mindset than the previous pharaohs. Now, this pharaoh didn't know the history of how the Jews saved Egypt from starvation under Joseph's leadership. But the new pharaoh exaggerated about the power of the Jews and their number and about them taking over. Egypt had a population of roughly 7 to 8 million people. The Israelites, after slavery had ended, had about 2 million, a lot less at this time before slavery started. But who cares? Who really cares about inconvenient facts when you have your own agenda to get across? Well, we all should care, because we cannot have a prosperous nation that's built on lies and cruelty. The Jews were going from being wealthy, powerful, and being fully assimilated into every aspect of Egyptian life to being rounded up and turned into slaves. And the taskmasters tried their best to crush their spirits, but they couldn't. The more they tried, the more the Jews multiplied. "Because my help comes from the Lord," the psalmist says, "they can't crush me." But God had other plans for his people. His timing for his people to live in a foreign land was up. It was time for them to go back home. And so God used this time of slavery to wake up the Jews into realizing that Egypt was not their home. That God had promised a land waiting for them, a land that they had inherited already and inhabited centuries ago. It was time to go home. But God also had to destroy this corrupt mindset of the new Pharaoh. Egypt was prosperous because of the Jews. But the threat of war with Syria turned Pharaoh into a racist leader, not unlike, as we saw before, how the U.S. treated Japanese Americans during World War II when Japan entered the war. This racist rhetoric of Pharaoh became so entrenched in his own administration that he couldn't change and let the people go free. He was so trapped by his own prejudices and greed that he was bound to fail. And since the Jews were building these cities with free labor, Pharaoh couldn't bring himself to letting them go and risk a collapse of the economy. The thing is, treating people right in the first place would have been a better approach. But Pharaoh was too corrupt to change his way of thinking. So after a series of confrontations between Moses and Pharaoh over letting the people go, the 9 plagues were just not enough to persuade Pharaoh to change his mind. Some of the plagues almost succeeded, but changing direction now by apologizing for his behaviors, by changing his views on race, by admitting mistakes, would have made him look weak, so he was trapped. Also, there's an old Latin proverb that says, to err is human. And so when leaders cannot admit to making mistakes, they implicitly state that they are not human like everyone else, but infallible like God. And this is the exact moment when God takes them down. And Pharaoh would rather see his country destroyed, lie in total ruins, than to admit to making a mistake. And this is what happened after a series of plagues. Egypt lie in ruins, but the worst was still yet to come. So Pharaoh was doomed. He was doomed already before the showdown with Moses even began. He was doomed because his kingdom was based on lies, racism, cruelty, arrogance, and the projection of being a godlike figure. Yes, he was doomed, and he didn't even realize it. And true to form, leaders won't be humbled until the plague strikes them personally and they see before their own eyes their gods, the very things that they hold dear to themselves, their gods, see their gods fall and crumble. So you can see where this is going. God told Moses plainly what he was going to do, what was going to happen. The death angel will move through the land, but it will pass over the Jews. That was revealed to Moses before he was thrown out of the palace, when he had this rough conversation or a tough conversation with Pharaoh about the destruction caused by the plague of darkness. But before leaving, and in a fit of rage, he warned Pharaoh of one last plague to come, the death angel striking the firstborn throughout all of Egypt. And then Moses stormed out and went to his people and prepared them for the most memorable time of their lives, a time that they would celebrate even today, telling them by faith, you will be set free. You will worship Jehovah God in your own land. Yes. You will be a great nation and have a posterity who lives in peace. Yes. There's not much time left. Get ready now. Let's go now. Yes. Leave at a moment's notice. And Exodus 12:12 says, I will go through the land of Egypt on this night and strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, whether human or animal, and bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am God. Ultimately, this is what God wants to accomplish at every level, personal and national, for all to see that he is God. And that the gods that we hold dear, they will fail us. And the same holds true for us today. The things that we hold dear are about to fall. They're about to fail us. They're falling now, and we should be falling on our knees and calling on God as being the only one who can save us. I was startled by this whole notion that some politicians, pushed by business leaders, are proposing today of sacrificing our older citizens to appease the God of Wall Street and the God of corporate America is a sign of desperation and total corruption and evidence that the moral path that we're on will not continue. Thinking like this, this corrupt thinking cannot stand. Leaders will find that it won't even matter what actions they take. Trying to balance lives versus economy, it doesn't matter what actions they take, because God will bring judgment on all the gods, all the things that we hold dear, all the gods of Egypt, and declare, I am God. And as Pharaoh was looked upon as a god, he himself would be brought down too. Verse 13, Exodus 12, the blood will serve as a sign on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. No disaster will touch you when I strike the land of Egypt. Then at midnight, the death angel passed through Egypt and struck down the firstborn, from Pharaoh's household to the prisoner locked up in jail to animals, servants, regular citizens. There was nothing but wailing throughout all Egypt, all through the night. No household was spared except those of the Jews who were covered by the blood. And this is our prayer for all of us here and listening in, that as this pandemic passes through PG and DC and elsewhere, God will spare us. But that also we'll be left with the knowledge that this world is not our home. We have another home in glory. Pharaoh called in Moses and Aaron that very night and said, get out of here and be done with you. You and your Israelites, go worship God on your own terms. And yes, he was resistant before to send along their livestock, but he said, and yes, take your sheep and cattle as you've insisted and go and bless me. Just a little nod to the power of God, but it wasn't enough. And thus, God's army, about 2 million strong, began to march to its promised land. But none of this death and destruction of the plagues on Egypt can compare to the final destruction of the non-believer who refuses to give his life or her life to Christ. Jesus calls it a place of unquenchable fire. We translate it as hell. But now is the time to humble ourselves before God, if we haven't already, and admit to making mistakes. Admit to falling short of God's standards. Admit that we need a Savior to save us from ourselves. And instead of being locked into the thinking of the past and holding on to our old way of thinking, accept the fact that God is love. And out of love, God the Father sent his Son, Jesus Christ, into this world to die on the cross to pay for our sins, our shortcomings, our mistakes. And that now we have an obligation to surrender our lives to him and to live for him. This is what God is accomplishing during this pandemic. Yes. Having us acknowledge that he is Lord. Yes. And that is, it is only by his grace. It's only by his grace that we stand. Amen. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord.